Ladies first, Team GB begins its gold medal campaign with women's football from Cardiff in half an hour. First on BBC One, we're preparing for Olympic glory.
One, two, three, go! Zubir's kite, and that view, we could only be in Kabul. Welcome to World Olympic Dreams from Afghanistan.
Coming up in this edition of the programme, the quest of this country's only Olympic medalist to redefine Afghanistan.
Feel the power just coming right up through here. Yeah. It's just amazing.
The incredible story of double amputee Malik Mohammed and the sport that saved his life. I'll meet the real strongmen of Kabul.
20 years of rowing, my legs are about that big. Check out this bicep. My fingers don't meet.
Plus, the athletes risking their lives for sport. The Afghan women's football team who play on in the face of death threats. This is Afghanistan as you've never seen it before. Through the stories of athletes who want to change how this country is seen forever.
As I can remember, the very word Afghanistan conjures up images of conflict and warfare. But I've been really keen to come here, and especially to Kabul, to see for myself if somewhere amongst all this there might be some sport. And the most obvious place to start is with one man who almost single-handedly has transformed the very idea of the Afghan athlete.
Taekwondo fighter Rahula Nikpai is without equal in Afghanistan. He is the only Olympic medalist in the history of this country. His bronze in the 2008 Beijing Olympics was a moment of national celebration, the like of which Afghanistan has all too few of. I'm on my way to meet Rahula with my guide in Afghanistan, journalist and broadcaster Tahir Kadiri.
So Tahir, how big a star is Rahula Nikpai?
Well, he's a really big star and a champion in Afghanistan, because the thing is, you know, the reason is we haven't got quite a lot of champions over the last three decades in Afghanistan because of war. And Rahula, on the other hand, was the first, you know, to bring the Olympic medal to Afghanistan in our history. You know, it was the first ever medal. And then there is so much publicity on TVs about him. He's doing advertisement for some of these, you know, telecommunication companies. He's doing advertisements for safety and sanitary in the country. I mean, people mob him on the street, and everybody knows him, from children to elders, because he has been so much on TV.
It's become a bit of a cliche when Olympic athletes say that winning a medal changes their life, but for Rahula on his return from Beijing, that was literally true. He had a huge reception, a new car, and this fantastic new apartment from the president of Afghanistan, no less.
Welcome to my house.
Thank you.
Rahula's quality of life was certainly transformed by Beijing, But for him, the medals he holds dear are worth so much more than the personal wealth they've brought him.
نه تنها برای ما که مهم است بلکه برای کشور ما برای تمام هموطنان ما مهم است ما از این طریق میتونیم دل هموطنان خود شاد کنیم از طریق مدالی که میگیریم از طریق از این افتخاراتی که کسب میکنیم برای کشور ما و خوشحال هستم که دل هموطنان خود تا حدودی میتونیم امروز از این مدال شاد کنیم
Winning medals is becoming a habit for Rahula. Last year in the Taekwondo World Championships in Korea, he consolidated his position as one of the best in his sport with another bronze medal, proving his 2008 Olympic bronze wasn't just a stroke of luck.
تلاش خودم میکنم بخیر در المپیک لندن هم که انشالله بخیر مدال بگیرم البته مدال بهتر میخوایم که مدال طلا رو بخیر نفع بگیرم از المپیک 2012 لندن و ما هستیم ما جوانان ما ورزشکارا هستیم که میتونیم از طریق ورزش از طریق این مدال های مهم کشور خود به جهان معرفی کنیم نه از طریق راه‌های منفی یا کدام مشکلات دیگه
Nearly 4 years on from that medal performance in Beijing, Rahula still uses this gym. It's the place where he started out in the outskirts of Kabul. It's pretty much a domestic house that's been converted. And you can see it's not even the correct width for a proper taekwondo mat.
For sure, Rahula will fight plenty of athletes in London with better training facilities than these. But from what I saw, his competitors would be foolish to underestimate the man from Kabul.
Force and power.
You can feel the power just coming right up through here. And the most worrying thing is, you can't even... From the moment his foot leaves the floor, you can't see it. Thank you.
An Olympic medal is always a turning point for any athlete. It's the moment when years of hard work in private, in places like this, become a matter of mass pride and a public celebration. That's more true of Rahula than many Olympic athletes. For him, the private and the public are the same thing. He believes if he can fight hard enough as an individual, his...
Of all the weird sights in Kabul, this place is probably the pinnacle. On a windy hilltop, right in the middle of the city, is almost an Olympic-sized swimming pool. It's about a quarter full, and perched on the end of it is this diving platform. It's been here for years, and the truth is that the Taliban would bring their victims here, march them up onto the board, and either shoot them there or from the end of the pool, and the bodies would fall into that water. Hundreds of them, apparently. It's pretty grim.
Afghanistan still has a long way to go before swimming pools represent sport rather than conjuring up dark memories. This empty, unused pool is a depressing sign of that. But there are glimmers of hope, too. Meet the Afghanistan water polo team. The squad, made up of farmers, shopkeepers and soldiers, is the brainchild of a US Marine who is hoping they can qualify for the 2016 Olympic Games. It's a tall order, though.
And this is what they're up against. This is one of only about a dozen swimming pools in the whole of Afghanistan. It's outside, so in winter it's completely unusable. And sports politics being what it is, the swimmers train here. The water polo players, they have to find somewhere else.
When I catch up with them, they're training in an indoor pool as the guests of a local businessman. It's a one-off, organized, we think, because we're filming. And it's not going according to plan.
A couple of problems. There are no goals that I can see, and a bit of confusion down the other end because there's no water polo ball. So someone's been sent to buy one, and hopefully We'll have some sport to watch in a minute or two.
Eventually, a ball, albeit a football, turns up and training can get underway. As sporting struggles go, it would take a lot to beat the Afghan water polo team. There is no tradition of aquatic sports in this landlocked country. Three of the team have been killed in the war, and a plan for a month's training in America is being blocked because of fears that some of the team will defect.
چاق میشدم وزن میگیره در بازی نمیتونم ما اینا بالخصوص خودم با تیم واتر پولو بسیار خوب هستم خوش دارم بسیار یک بازی مقبول است بسیار امروز کار کردیم بسیار خوشم اومد همه جانم بسیار هم تکان داد خوشم اومد واقعا در صورت هم آدم زیاف میشه در بازی آرزوی من است که یک تیم واتر پولو جور کنیم با ساب که مثلا آمریکا یا کانادا یا آلمان یا فرانسه یک جایی بریم که بعد مسابقه دادن که بفهمن که افغان اینقدر کمک همکاری آلمانیا بود بر افغان ها که اینقدر یاد گرفتن.
You can't help feeling it'll be well beyond 2016 before these players have a hope of holding their own internationally. Even so, Rahula Nikpai's Olympic medal in 2008 is proof enough to these players that it can be done. In Afghanistan, perhaps more than anywhere else in the world, sporting dreams survive against overwhelming odds. The emergence of water polo and other fledgling sports here reveals wider truths about the struggle going on in Afghanistan as a whole, something I'm keen to know more about from Tahir.
So just tell me what sport means in Afghanistan at the moment.
Well, the sport means quite a lot. After the fall of the Taliban, the two great achievements Afghanistan had, one was the freedom of media, and the other one was the sport. All of a sudden, you saw, you know, like an explosion of sports in Afghanistan and athletes coming from, middle of nowhere, really. Like the cricket, for example, a great example, you know, they came out of the ashes and then they became like a global, you know, phenomenon. These athletes with very little facilities, they try to express themselves and, you know, express your identities, you know, through a different way and to introduce, you know, a new image from Afghanistan other than the one, the usual one, which is always associated with war and drugs.
Redefining what it means to be not just an Afghan, but an Afghan athlete, is also what's driving 18-year-old Malik Mohammed.
It was 2005, near Kabul airport. I lost my legs by lineman, you know. The bomb was from Russian people. It was minefield. So, and I lost both of my legs. In one time, I can say, because it was two bombs, you know,
yeah.
And blew off me to the air and came down, another one is explosion, like...
Two in a row.
Yes.
Those two bombs, planted before he was even born, changed Malik's life unimaginably. After injury and horror came the realization that he was now part of a kind of underclass. In Afghanistan, the disabled are all too often regarded as invisible or even worthless.
We have like 1 million disabled and paralyzed like me in Afghanistan, but they are jobless, they are very poor family, so they cannot do work, they cannot do anything in Kabul city or whenever we are there, so this is a big problem between disabled and not disabled.
Malik was flown to the US for treatment. Several years, not just of American medical care, but also of education, changed his life again. He met former presidents, made new friends, and discovered sport. He returned to Kabul not just as a track athlete, but also as a swimmer, with a sense of self-worth which might otherwise have eluded him.
And what would your life be like without sport?
If I didn't do a sport, I have a been like a simple person, stay at home and do nothing, watch only TV. So now I am a sportsman and people call me athletes and hero. So I am very proud of myself.
It's amazing what sport can do for people in Afghanistan. In the days and months after Malik lost his legs, the chances were he was going to become almost a pariah in Afghan society. Now, he's a hero for the whole country.
This summer in London, Malik hopes to represent Afghanistan in the 2012 Paralympic Games. He'll be banishing some personal demons for sure. But if he can change what it means to have a disability here, then perhaps the biggest impact from his efforts in London will be felt back at home. There are so many sporting stories to be told in Afghanistan. The lid has been lifted here. Afghans are throwing themselves into all kinds of sports. Not all the trends here are new, though. There is one craze in particular, which, like cricket, went on during the Taliban, but is now booming like never before.
Tell me about bodybuilding. Why is that such a big sport in Afghanistan?
Well, maybe you are not to the right person because I haven't got good muscles, but anyway, I will answer you. You know, bodybuilding, after the fall of the Taliban, it's one of the favorite sports in Afghanistan. Every Afghan, especially the youngsters you speak to, they go to gym.
It's not a new thing. I mean, this hasn't happened in the last two or three years. This has been generations.
Well, yes, yeah, it has been going on for years and years, even during the Taliban. I mean, they were asked to wear pants and cover, you know, their legs and also some parts of their chest as well. But after the Taliban, you know, now they can show each part of their body. So let me tell you one thing. When you go and propose a girl, one of the criteria is having a good body in Afghanistan. So you need to have a good muscles, you know, to propose a good girl.
To get a good wife.
Exactly.
If that's true, then these guys should have no trouble getting a good wife.
This is lunchtime in Kabul, in one of many weightlifting gyms, and these bodybuilders have put on a show, specifically for us, it has to be said. I've been in plenty of gyms in my life, but I've never seen anything like this.
This gym is brand new. It brings the number in Kabul alone to around 200. The sport, if you can call it that, isn't just about spending hours in gyms, though. All of these bodybuilders regularly compete in contests that take place right across the country, culminating every year in the Mr. Afghanistan competition. Contestants are scored on different parts of the body, so knowing how to flex on demand is crucial.
So check this out. 20 years of rowing, my legs are, about that big. Check out this. Bicep. My fingers don't meet.
Jabbar Hotak could have been the next Rahullah Nikpai. His first sport was Taekwondo. Before too long, bodybuilding became his obsession, though. It's a passion which climaxed with him being crowned Mr. Afghanistan in 2009. Now as a trainer, he's uniquely placed to know what makes bodybuilders tick. Where there are prizes, of course, there is cheating. Notably, steroids. These bodybuilders all say they rely on weightlifting alone to build up their muscle, but they know plenty of people here willing to turn to chemicals to gain an advantage.
So why is this place called the Bush Bazaar?
Well, after the former president of the United States. So when the
Tahir brought me to a market where steroids are for sale.
So when the Taliban fell from power, people started setting up markets like this one, because most of you can find, you know, most of the American staff here, where the soldiers don't consume them, and then they bring them here and people just try to buy.
So we've obviously seen the bodybuilders, mm-hmm. when they're looking for supplements or even the steroids that some of them use, mm-hmm. is this the kind of place they're going to come
to? Well, you have come to the right place. Get in. I think this is one of the shops. So here you can get everything. Steroids, you know, you can get the weight gainer.
And is this something that people are worried about?
The thing is, you know, there is not so much knowledge about this. There is not so much publicity even on TV. So I've heard quite a lot of reports, really. I mean, the recent one was like a friend. He died of using so much, too much steroids. So that was like a big bang, like that was like a warning for all people. And then
doping is certainly a very worrying part of this sport. Testing is still only sporadic, and while there remains a real chance of not being caught, plenty of bodybuilders will continue to use. There is more freedom than ever in sport in Afghanistan, but there are many who'd argue, in the world of bodybuilding at least, freedom to participate and freedom to abuse should not be confused.
You're never too far from signs of conflict in Kabul. This was the gym where we were just filming those bodybuilders, and right next door, that tall building, is where the Taliban launched an attack from a few months ago. That was onto the American embassy, which is a couple of blocks that way, and you can still see the bullet holes in the top of that building where the Americans fired back.
Kabul is one of the most dangerous cities in the world. And as a result, moving around, you come across checkpoints every few hundred meters.
Oh, stop check.
Understandably, they don't like being filmed. In Kabul, you're constantly aware how dangerous things can be here. But equally, life in a high security world can also become very normal very quickly.
We've been here 2-3 days. And you just get used to it. It's worrying how you get to it. You think, to begin with, it's a complete culture shock, and now it's just normal. Armed guard, guy comes to the window, say what you're doing, and then you can carry on with life.
Even though my main focus in Afghanistan has been sport, you're constantly hit with the evidence of the political side of this country's recent past.
This is the Ghazi Stadium. If you've seen pictures of this before, they're unlikely to have been pleasant ones. It's here that the Taliban used to bring people in to execute them in front of the crowds and even stone women to death out on the pitch. But nowadays, there's progress. There's a lovely new AstroTurf pitch, and this stadium is the hub of a whole sports complex which aims at improving Afghan team sports.
Among them, the Afghanistan women's football team. Women's sport wasn't just restricted under the Taliban, it was completely banned. The contrast between the present day and a mere 11 years ago is at its starkest here. As recently as 2001, any of these women could have been executed for what we're filming them doing today. That's not to say that this is uncontroversial even now. The role of women in Afghanistan is a battle that is far from settled. Many of the players here have had death threats. Each of the women on this pitch has their own story of sacrifice to tell for the love of the game that they play.
افراد تیم من بسیار ورزشکارا بسیار کم بودن اول فامیل کم مخالفت نشان دادن و بعدا دیدن که من خودم بسیار علاقه دارم و متوجه خود بودم میتونم اونا مرا اجازه دادن و گفتن که خب ما تو به خدا میسپاریم دیگه کدام مشکل دیگه نداریم و از اجازه فامیل هم داشتم و اونا زیاد مرا تشویق کردن کم کم و تا فعلا هم امرای همکاری دارن و تشویق میکنن مرا.
This is where progress in sport is at its most delicate. Women's sport happens in Afghanistan, you could say, despite public attitudes, not because of them. Even so, Sajia and the rest of her teammates remain committed. The team is beginning to play internationals overseas, and home matches have drawn surprising numbers of spectators.
قسم یک دخترای ما بسیار علاقمندی میان فوتبال میکنن اونا صرف میخواین که به مردم افغانستان خصوصا مردم شهر کابل کنا بسیار یک روی بسیار غلط یک ذهنیت بسیار غلط در مقابل فوتبال دخترا کلا در مقابل ورزش دخترا داره میخواین به اونا بفهمانیم که ورزش در افغانستان تنها از مردان نیست بلکه دخترا میتونن ورزش کنن و چی فوتبال باشه چی کدوم ورزش دیگه باشه هیچ کدوم چی نیست و مهم است که ما عضویت داشته باشیم در یک تیم و بتونیم در پلی مردا بتونیم ما ورزش کنیم و بازی کنیم.
What happens with the women's football team more than any of the other athletes I've encountered will be a barometer of the bigger story here in Afghanistan. In 5 or 10 years' time, this team may well no longer exist. Or it may be, if Sadia has anything to do with it, the Afghan women's football team has gone from strength to strength.
To round off our trip, you couldn't get a more Afghan backdrop than the presidential palace, which was ruined in the fighting in the civil war. But you never know with Afghanistan. You could come back in 6 months' time and that could be completely razed to the ground, or it could be reinvented as a government building or even some sort of luxury hotel. You just don't know. And when I think back to the few days, it's been absolutely amazing to get under the skin of the place and to really witness the truth about Afghan sport. You think of Malik and Rahula, who are absolutely at the cutting edge. They're inspirations to the whole nation and to generations of people who are coming up behind them and realizing that it is possible. It is possible to go to the Olympics or the Paralympics and win medals. And then you think of the kind of more rough and ready reality of Afghan sport, the kind of cricket that goes on in the streets and in the towns, and then the, you know, the chaos of the Afghan water polo team. And the only sign off, I think, is that there can be no definitives. You can't look at the country or Kabul as a city or the political situation or indeed Afghan sport without the one thought cropping up, which is what on earth is going to happen next. From this edition of World Olympic Dreams from Kabul and from Afghanistan, it's goodbye.